Plain Arena by Queen Victoria's 70th Lancers Cavalry Display Team. I shall hand you over to Mr. Alan Larson, who will do the commentary for this show. Alternatively, just to let you know, in the Inner Bailey at the moment, the Victorian musicians Hot Boys are currently playing. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Old Sarum. In front of you, you see the riders of the 17th Lancers Display Team, who represent the men of that most famous of British cavalry regiments, as they were in 1879. The 17th Lancers, known as the Death or Glory Boys, from their unique badge or motto of a skull and crossbones worn on their appointments. In 1879, the 17th, who had made their name 20 years earlier in the charge of the Light Brigade, found themselves in Africa, taking on the Zulu armies of King Shetsweyo to avenge a defeat at Isandlwana. You notice that the men are all riding matched dark bay horses of about 15 or 16 hands in height. Some of the potential damage that can be wreaked with this weapon. It was said that a trained lancer was the most effective of cavalrymen. A man who was not trained was an encumbrance to himself and a danger to his horse. Let's hope we see more of the former, less of the latter today. Ladies and gentlemen, the 17th Lancers Display Team. Now, in the days before radio communications on the battlefield, the best way of making through the bugle. For example, if he was stood by his horse and the order came down to tack up the horse, the order boots and saddles would be played. Especially on a rested horse. So that sends the men scurrying to their horses, boots and saddles on man and horse. They're formed up and they prepare to move off. They move into the walk. The order would be given, troop, walk, march. They'd increase the pace into the trot, trot, march. Now the next gear up in our cavalryman's gearbox, third gear, known to us as the canter, was known in the late 19th century as the gallop. The order would be troop, gallop, march. At this stage, the regiment is advancing in line. Their lances have come down, and it remains only for them to close to the enemy. The horses have got their heads well out. The men are excited. And here comes the order that they've all been waiting for. 17th Lancers, charge! And it was that call that was given as the 17th leave, and share a little of it with you later on.
That was good.
To the regiment, all the way from the valleys. Correction, my fault, he's moved around, he's behind me. The next rider along, an experienced old hand, with the face, I think, of a desperate, embittered old soldier. Trooper John Willis, on Dusty.
So Dusty.
He'll be competing in the sword competition, in which he will attempt to wreak havoc upon Mellon's place demonstration for the sword competition. This will be between Trumpeter Wishart and Trooper Willis. They will each need to see us off. We trust. Ladies and gentlemen, 1.5 points have Trooper Willis on Dusty.
Come in.
See some pace, Trumper. A slice, and a slice. 1.5 points for Wishart. A slice, and a miss, but a nice try. Yes! Ladies and gentlemen, it remains a draw. He tries for the point, misses, and a slice. Triple Wall is going for the point, and the slice, it's a hack. Yes, 2 points. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the winner of the sword competition on Dusty, Triple Willis. Dusty showing his...
Hey, gentlemen. Back! And it looks as if we have a touch. Trip is silent. Well, I'm waiting for a decision now. Yes. It's worth bearing in mind that leaning out of the saddle at that speed requires a considerable degree of faith in your horse. If the horse decides at that moment to make a complete ass of you by dropping his shoulder, you're on the ground. No way around that. Now, hard-working ground staff, replace the pegs. Second run, gentlemen, peg! Yes! Spectacular! I can see from here that both Tripper Finney and Corporal Sarwood have got 2 points each. Ladies and gentlemen, Corporal Sarwood, Tripper Finney.
Veterans enough to keep the soldiers or to keep the opposition at a safe distance. Most of the opposition were not yet, thankfully, armed with firearms.
Shoulder! Arms!
During the Zulu campaign, it was the first time that the Zulus had come across a European soldier who was prepared to go hand-to-hand with them. And it's a reputation the British Army still has, being prepared to get in there with the cold steel. Now it may look rather peculiar pointing the bayonet up like that. Granted, there were no paratroopers in those days, but you just see the cavalry, and of course, pointing it up, you'd be able to attack either the horse or its rider. If you're on a parapet, which medal, we're looking at this lot, I doubt it. Okay, we now have the ammunition bearer coming out. Although the soldiers were equipped with a certain amount of ammunition prior to going into action, if they had the time, or for an exercise.
The idea of the skirmisher was to draw fire away from the main body, and also to identify where the opposition were, so they could engage them. Being done at a leisurely pace. The soldiers are working together, moving forward, keeping an eye out for the opposition, signalling to each other. We'll get a bit loud in a moment, so for the little ones, mums and dads, hands over ears at the ready. As you can see, the troops are lined up, two ranks, a technique that wouldn't have been unfamiliar to Wellington or Napoleon 50 odd years previously, more like 60. The Martini Henry fires a soft lead round. It travels fairly slowly, and when it hits a target, it deforms. The bullet goes in, spreads out like a mushroom, makes an extremely large and unpleasant wound on the other side. Of course, there is a lesson here, don't fire into wind because you get your own back. But as you can see, a large amount of smoke is produced. This obviates the need for camouflage, because the moment you open fire, your enemy can see.
The idea being that one rank will move forward whilst covered by the other rank. As you saw in the volley, everybody fired at once, so for a short time, the section was unloaded. This technique, the section was already loaded. You'll also see the soldiers are spread out when they were with the volley. A large section could mean that the volleys on either flank could be 3 yards apart. closer.
Form rally in square! Rally!
Sultan's forming a rally in square.
Firing at will. Absolutely. Sooner or later, unfortunately, the soldiers are running out of ammunition. And we resort to the traditional fallback of the bayonet. The last resort. The Zulus later said this. Like lions, they fought, and the red soldier, how they fell like stones, each one in his place.
Swordsman.
Fall in! To ranks!
I'll do that charge in the car.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our display. So take your cue from the sergeant.
For Her Majesty, Queen Victoria! Hip hip!
Huzzah!
Hip hip!
Huzzah!
Hip hip!
Huzzah!
Of the exploits of the great Duke of Marlborough. The soldiers you see here represent the English army of 300 years ago. Lord Orkney's regiment was also entitled the Royal Regiment of Foot and is the first of the line infantry regiments. It's 1702 and England is again at war with France. In 1700 the King of Spain died and the 16-year-old French Duke of Anjou succeeded to the throne. England supported the Austrian claim. The idea of both France and Spain are traditional enemies.
It's against France. No seeks young men for service in the Low Countries in the present troubles. All clever fellows who are free, able, and ambitious of becoming gentlemen by the bearing of arms are invited to offer their services to their country. They are promised to meet with every encouragement that merit and good behaviour may entitle them. These volunteers shall immediately receive Her Majesty's bounty and clothing, arms and accoutrements, and 8 pence per day for the length of their service. God save Queen Anne!
So you see a typical of the army of 300 years ago. The Rome once called a frog coat a great deal.
Present! Fire!
Now, you'll notice that we had a flash in the pan on our back rank man.
Rescue fire lock.
This is by
your left face and fire in your own time.
Now it is a slow process, even sped up, but of course, bear in mind that the other fellow on the French side is working at exactly the same pace with exactly the same military technology.
Chelmsford had around about 6 battalions put out in three separate columns. The central column are infantrymen here today, in the section, under that smallest working group you'd have, under the command of an NCO. They're actually in battle order. Infantrymen in Africa didn't have the luxury of rail transport. They marched everywhere. The African terrain is very inhospitable, leaving the brass buttons of gone on campaign. Replaced by practical uniforms, our soldiers are not looking the same as they would normally do and how the public would have perceived them. Sighted up to 1800 yards is most effective from 400 yards down, and at 100 yards it will stop a running man in his tracks and put a standing man flat on his back. Silas, the great South African game hunter, recommended the Martini Henry as the perfect weapon to kill bull elephants with. If you can bring a bull elephant down with it, think what it does to a human being. It was most effective at its sights at Isandlwana. The Imperial Infantry Companies, when they were standing close shoulder to shoulder, were capable of firing 10 to 12 aimed rounds a minute. 800 men firing that, you can work out the amount of lead that was going in the general direction of the enemy.
No.
And our tactics were very much that. You weren't interested in hitting an individual. Marksmanship wasn't necessary. If there are 20,000 Zulus coming at you, what you're trying to do is hit someone in that mass. The idea being that if you hit enough of them, their morale's going to collapse and they're not going to keep coming. The Martini Henry gave those soldiers that natural edge. And the centre companies...
...to come here today, unpaid to perform for you. Ladies and gentlemen, the 17th Lancers display team! Now, first of all, I think you'll be impressed by the sheer bulk of man and horse. These horses are all 15 or 16 hands in height, matched bays, ridden by men, all over 5'6" in height. Magnify this into 260 men, and you can probably imagine the ground literally shaking underneath you as they come on at the gallop. Drilling on horseback is quite an achievement in itself. These men are all volunteers who have to train in their own time to master the very difficult art of managing a horse with one hand, bear in mind that each horse has to be kept in place in its line. The impact and success of the charge of the Lancers depends on delivering as many men in a straight line as possible, with as much impact and as much speed. A trooper would train for all of his career, depending on that fateful day when he actually charged the enemy. By the time the 17th reached the Zulu Wars, they had already achieved enormous fame as one of the smartest cavalry regiments in the British Army, the Death or Glory Boys, or Pipe Clay Boys as they were known, and had charged at the charge of the Light Brigade in October 1854. One of the six regiments participating, they formed the centre of the front rank, and at the end of the day, two-thirds of the horses and nearly half of the men were disabled or killed. The Death or Glory badge was hard won. Ladies and gentlemen, I think you'll appreciate that formation riding. The 17th Lancers have appeared at a number of venues over the years. They're a collaboration between English Heritage, the Troop, which is a multi-period cavalry reenactment group, and the successor regiment to the 17th Lancers, the Queen's Royal Lancers. The Death or Glory badge is still in current use in the British Army, and consequently, required the blessing of the current regiment in order that the display team could be formed from civilian riders. They've given it their blessing, and not only that, they've come along and supported us in a number of appearances, including the Royal Tournament. Now, orders were Now, we're going to have a closer look at the Lancers and their horses. First of all, some of the strain off of him. His chest is painted white. Incredibly, this is still essentially a Napoleonic uniform, being worn in an era when rifle weapons were in use. The 17th line, perhaps the most obvious feature on the horse's offside, is a carbine carried in a long bucket. Now this is a single-shot Martini carbine carried on the man and the horse. This led to an incredible wastage of horses. The 17th took nearly 500 horses to South Africa. 3 months later, due to sickness and lack of feed, and the fact that the pampered English horses would not touch the African grass, the wastage had reduced the regiment to something like 260 men on horseback. Drop! Right! About! and Sovereign. The diehards come on. Under the command of Sergeant Gilmore, a very experienced soldier, both as a reenactor and with 12 years in the Grenadier Guards. You're very welcome to join in, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, the soldiers of the Queen!
Larson, as you said, do feel free to step over the tape barrier and come and chat to 70th Lancers and meet their horses. Don't forget, you've seen the Victorian Army in the arena today. Have a go yourself in 5 minutes' time with Sergeant Claude Horatio Ringwood.
That's enough,
I'm
isn't it?
I'm going to keep choosing people in the audience because they really are helping an awful lot. Who else? This young man here.
Yeah. Goes on. Right,
he didn't do it this way because he went the wrong turn.
What's the island on that?
Oh, I don't know, that surf and outburst.
It's carved from one piece of staghorn, and the crown's the bit that attaches to the head. And that's come, well, it's basically that large, and it fits in there very tight. I just pull that round. It's been reinforced with a piece of iron in here, and it's held in place with this gut. And this